This
Yeah,
conference
like
will
I
now
told
be
her before.
recorded.
You see, this is the mobile phone. Can anyone tell what are the sensors present in a smart mobile phone?
Yes, meter.
No, meter. He allowed our phones.
See, the smartphone nowadays is inevitable. Everyone is carrying it. Without this smartphone, you cannot travel anywhere. You cannot communicate anyone. We cannot talk to anyone. Though our friends are sitting next to us, we use only WhatsApp to chat. So that has become the situation nowadays. So if you take any smartphone, it has got a lot of sensors. Can anyone tell what are the sensors present, the standard sensors present in a general, a basic smartphone? As I'm a teacher, I want the session to be more interactive. It should not be monotonous, so that only the presenter will be keep on talking and others are listening without any response. That's a challenge normally we are facing in online classes nowadays in the past 2 years because of this pandemic. So if you take the smartphone, the basic sensor starts from this camera. Okay, so without this camera, this meeting is not possible. This online meeting is not possible. Without this camera, this meeting is not possible. Then we have accelerometer, gyroscope, vibration sensor, right, very good. A proximity sensor. So depending upon the quality and the model of the phone, lot of sensors are used nowadays. Okay, even our phone has become one remote control. You take a Redmi phone, it has got IR sensors so that we can operate all our electronic gadgets at home, like AC, refrigerator, TV. All these things are operated with a smartphone. Sensors are becoming inevitable. Okay, that's why it is mentioned as sensors are omnipresent. Okay, everywhere, wherever you go, some sensors are available in some form. Okay. To continue, before continuing, let me present one small video which I took from this. I'll play one video. Most of you might have seen this. Is this visible?
Yes, sir. Visible, sir. Video, it is visible, sir.
Audio is coming.
Without audio, sir. Audio is not coming.
Oh, I don't know what happened to audio. Okay, video. This is available in YouTube. This interesting engineering is one video channel where you can get all these things. Very interesting videos are available in that. So this is a small video telling about how sensors are introduced in our life. Okay, Google is working on this development of sensors. These are implanted. I'll show one more video later after seeing some of the basics. Let me start with this introduction about the definition. So what is a sensor? There are a lot of definitions given for a sensor. One of the definition given by ANSI, the American National Standards Institute, is like this: a device which provides an usable output in response to a specific measurement. So measurement may be any physical or mechanical or electrical or any optical parameter. It's a it is called a measurement, the input. It's called a stimulus. So a sensor acquires a physical parameter and converts into a signal suitable for processing. You see the picture. This is similar to this our collection. So I am talking to a mic, which is converted to electrical signal, and it is being communicated to you through this GoToMeeting. Okay. So mic has got. There are a lot of microphones. So that is a different area. So the sensor simply acquires the physical parameter and converts this my voice into suitable signal like this electrical pulses, so that these are processed and communicated to you. Another definition is, it's a device that senses or detects a signal. The signal may be in any form of energy. It may be converted into one form of energy to another form. So this act of conversion is called as transducing. So transducing is a common term, because a transducer is a common device which is doing conversion of one energy to another energy. So sensor is one type of transducer. The other type of transducer is called actuator. So actuator will get one electrical signal. It will convert this into some physical parameter. So the opposite operation is done by the transducer, that actuator. Okay. So you see this example: speedometer fitted in a car converts the wheel rotation into the reading. So at what speed your vehicle is running, based on the rotation of the car wheel, this is being sensed by a sensor fitted in the car. It is connected to the speedometer, which shows at what speed you are driving the car. So basically, a sensor is used as an input function. So there's a difference. A device which performs an input function is called a sensor, because it senses a physical change in some characteristic. Okay, physical may be the length or the shape or some form of, we are going to see what are the parameters. Okay, the physical change, the variation in the physical change is sensed by this device, and this is converted to some other form. Okay, it is responding to some excitation. For example, heat or force is sensed, and it is converted into electrical signal. You see, most of you would have seen this. Okay, in this pandemic period, everyone might have got this device at home. Okay, so this is a digital thermometer. So at the tip, you got one sensor. Okay, so the sensor simply senses the temperature below the tank or wherever you are keeping, and this is converted to electrical signal, and it is processed inside this electronic circuit, and it shows the temperature either in Celsius or Fahrenheit, how it is programmed, how you are selecting the option. Similarly, there is another device which performs an output function which is opposite of sensor. Okay, so the device which performs an output function is called actuator, and is used to control some external device, for example, movement. So both sensors and actuators are collectively called as transducers, because both of them basically convert energy of one kind into energy of another kind. So what's the need for sensor? So in the keynote address, our chief guest, our HOD, everyone told about the importance of sensor, the availability of sensor across the world. Globally, it is available. We cannot avoid sensor in our life. So why this sensor is required? So sensor, the first slide I mentioned that it is omnipresent in both living beings and non-living beings. Living being in the sense it is not only human beings. You take a plant, you take an animal, you take or a fly. That's why I put a honeybee picture. Okay, honeybee with the antenna. It senses where it is able to collect the honey. Okay. And these animals, I don't know how many of you know that a big elephant can pick one small needle from a smooth surface with this trunk. So it is capable of sensing that much small needle. So similar sensors are available everywhere with all animals. Okay, you take a blue whale. People used to say a blue whale can sense its prey about 1 kilometer away. Okay, so it's capable of sensing its prey from a long distance. So like that, every animal, every living being has got its own sensor all over the world. So the need for sensor in living being is for existence, for survival. Okay, you take our own body, we got ears, eyes, nose. If any one of the sensory organs is not working, we find difficult. So most of the people, patients affected by corona, they don't feel, they cannot taste, they cannot sense, smell, both smell and taste, they lost. So that is a symptom for corona. So if these symptoms are not present, suppose already corona is infected, they have normal feeling of taste and smell, then diagnosis will become difficult. Okay, so for living beings, the sensors are required very much for existence as well as for longevity, for extending their life for 60 years, 80 years, 90 years, 100 years. Okay, whenever you feel something is wrong in your lungs or heart, you diagnose it immediately, you rectify it, so that we can live for more years. Whereas you come to non-living beings, which are man-made, what's the need? So we make this sensors for four reasons. One is for automation, okay, for transportation. So I am simply sitting here. I want to move to the next block or next campus or next city. I cannot walk. So I have to depend on some automated vehicle, either a two-wheeler or four-wheeler, which should move on its own. So I should not use my physics. I should not use my hand or legs for moving, so that my energy will be wasted. So automation purpose, we develop a lot of sensors and fit them with the transport. Okay. Then for comfort purpose, like smart home, smart city, smart vehicle, smart farms. I got agriculture field. I fit a lot of sensors all over the paddy field or any crop, to monitor whether any pest has come, whether I have to put a manure, whether water is present. See, this is one sensor which is meant for sensing humidity. Okay. This is another sensor which can sense two parameters, temperature and humidity. These are some sensors your students might have used for projects with the Arduino or Raspberry Pi. Okay, so I'll come to this point. What's the difference between this type of sensor and sensors used in industries? Okay, at home, I am using this sensor, This is called a gas sensor. I can fit this at my kitchen so that if there's a leakage in my LPG cylinder, my electronic circuit will send an alarm so that some gas is leaking whenever I'm out of office or out of kitchen, so that either some safety measure should be taken, or it may call the fire service people. So this is a gas sensor. Okay, so we can use this for comfort, safety, and security. Security, you see on camera. Nowadays, every home is fitted with the CCTV. Wherever you are going, you are leaving the home, your mobile will have this app. Through this, you are monitoring anybody is coming, who is coming at what time, who is leaving, if a theft has occurred, how it has occurred. So police department is able to track the sequence of the theft because of this CCTV. So camera plays a major role. So for comfort, safety, security, sensors are required. And if you take any system means it may be applicable to economics or industry, for manufacturing industry or any product development, these sensors are required to study, monitor, and control the performance of a sensor, of a system. Okay, system may be our human system. Okay, I may be fitted with a lot of ECG sensors, EEG electrodes. So my brain activity, my heart activity can be monitored, and the doctor can diagnose what's the problem with the person. Like that, in industry also, you take a boiler plant, a lot of sensors you can feed. What's the status of the boiler, whether it is emitting all the heat properly or any leakage is there. So like that, sensors are used everywhere. So nobody can claim that this sensors belong to only electrical engineer or electronics engineer or computer engineer or civil engineer. Okay, nowadays even civil engineers, they are using sensors. They are all fitted at our home, so that even if a small fracture occurs, the small crack occurs, this can be immediately indicated to the house owner. Okay, so in the beam, you can fit a sensor so that everyone can identify during any thunder or earthquake. If anything happens, they can easily sense. Another thing is to improve productivity and quality of products. Okay, so you would have seen a lot of videos. In the automation, a lot of, you say, cakes or some food items or some mechanical sub-products or manufactured ancillary units are there. We have the automation unit where some spare parts are manufactured. Suppose they are making one screw, the screw is not proper. If you use it in a machine, the machine may malfunction. Its life may come down. So the quality of the product has to be monitored so that the overall productivity can be improved, so that the manufacturing unit will be benefited, the customer will be benefited. So it is not only related to the manufacturer, the owner, it is the benefit comes to everyone in the society. So sensors are very much required everywhere, anytime. Okay. That's why in IoT, they used to say Internet of Things, anytime, anywhere, anybody. So like that, if you say anywhere, anytime, anybody, the sensors are required. If you don't have a sensor, there are no IoT, there are no artificial intelligence, there are no machine learning, there are no manufacturing unit, no automation, no comfort, no safety. So how the sensors are classified? There are so many parameters under which sensors are classified. Based on the operation, sensors are classified like, any doubt? Audience can raise that doubt in between. So this based on the operation, a sensor may be active sensor or passive sensor. So active sensor is one which requires external power for its operation. Whereas passive sensors does not require any external power. Okay, I told this is a thermistor. Okay, this is another thermistor. I got many sensors around my table. Okay, you see what is present here, the same thing. Okay, this is used in air conditioner, same thermistor. This thermistor is used in your thermometer. Okay, so this thermistor does not require any external power, just the external temperature is sensed by it. According to it, its resistance varies. How much resistance is varying, based on that we are able to identify what's the external temperature. So this does not require any external power. It simply senses the temperature, its resistance varies. Whereas passive sensors does not need any additional energy source. Sorry, active sensor, this is a active sensor, this requires external power. This passive sensor does not need any additional energy source. They directly generate electrical signal, thermocouple I don't have right now. We have photodiode. Simply pass light on the diode, electrical signals will come. Okay, we are not powering the diode. Based on the intensity of the light, the diode will generate electrical signal. Similarly, piezoelectric sensor. So if you apply pressure or vibration, it will generate electrical signal. Or you apply voltage, it will operate on the other side. So this piezoelectric sensor can be called as both sensor actuator as actuator. Plays dual role. We'll see later. Okay. Then based on value, what type of value it is producing, sensor may be absolute sensor or relative sensor. So absolute sensor is one which detects the input, the stimulus, in reference to absolute physical scale. The same example, thermistor. It is not having any reference. What is the external temperature? Directly it present the independent value. Okay. There is no reference value for this. Yeah, Sarmana Chakravarti, I too agree. Photodetectors require power supplies depending upon application. Okay, most of the places nowadays, almost all sensors are active. Very rare passive sensors like thermocouples are used. And piezoelectric sensor, you take our watch, we have a piezoelectric crystal. Okay, piezoelectric crystal for generating pulses, for clock pulses to our RC, LC circuit, you require a piezoelectric sensor. So your watch is operating, it is having one battery, but that is not, that is applying voltage to the sensor, which produces pulses. Whereas a relative sensor produces a signal that relates to some special cases, same thermocouple. Okay, thermocouple based on the reference temperature gradient. Okay, what type of electrodes you are using, what type of temperature gradient, the electrical voltage will vary. Okay, it is not fixed for all temperature gradient, all environment. So some baseline is required. Based on the baseline only, the electrical voltage will vary. So that type of sensor is called a relative sensor. And based on the material, a sensor may be organic sensor or inorganic sensor. The organic sensor may be insulators, maybe liquid gas or plasma. Inorganic sensors are conductors, semiconductors, or biological substances. And how the sensor converts a value. Based on that, we have three types, like physical sensor, chemical sensor, biological sensor. So what type of conversion? Whether it converts physical value to electrical value, chemical value to electrical signal, or biological value to electrical signal. So based on that, sensors may be classified like this. And based on the input, the stimulus, sensors may be acoustic sensor, mechanical sensor, biological sensor, chemical sensor, electric sensor, magnetic, optical, radiation, thermal. These are very few. Okay, nowadays we got millions of sensors used across the world. But most of them will come under any one of this domain. And the output of the sensor, whether it is pure digital signal or analog signal. Most of this, you take this humidity, I think nowadays during Corona, these sensors would have seen non-contact. The security people, when you are going to office, they will show this gun and the sensor will sense the temperature. This is called a non-contact sensor. Okay, so this is a small non-contact sensor. So this will send the radiation, the body heat, and it will convert into electrical signal. And similarly for SpO2 testing, okay, saturation of oxygen, clip type of sensor is fixed. Based on that, how much oxygen is saturated. If it is above 95 and 99, you are safe. If it is less than 90%, you are abnormal. Okay. So for that case, we are using this type of SpO2 sensor. So these are very much used in the past one year. Okay. So you know, for electronics engineer, not only electronics, electrical, anybody can make this on their own. If you purchase it, it will be expensive. If you purchase the sensor on your own and make your own sensor, this will be cheaper. Okay. So the sensor may be analog sensor or digital sensor. So the conversion phenomena, I told you physical, chemical, and biological. There are so many phenomena involved in the physical conversion. It may be thermal to electrical, photo to electrical, that is light to electric, light to magnetic, magnetic to electric, electromagnetic. So like this, there are so many sensors available. Depending upon the application, any one of this we are using. Okay, you see this, this now I show. So this is thermo electric, okay. So the thermal, the heat is converted to electrical signal. Okay, you take this mic where this acoustics, okay, the vibration is converted to electrical signal. Okay, on the other end, you got the speaker where the electrical signal is applied to the mic speaker, which produces vibration. Okay, that's the actuator, this is the sensor. Okay. So chemical conversion, it may be chemical transformation. I'll show one more sensor. I don't know how many of you have seen this. So this is called a pH sensor. Okay. So this pH sensor is very much used in industries to measure the pH value of the fluid. And in agriculture also, actually, we are trying to implement some smart farming. I am working on Internet of Medical Things and smart farm in agriculture field, how IoT can be implemented. So that's why I got a lot of sensors for my research purpose. So this is a pH sensor where some electrodes are there. I have to dip the fluid in the fluid. So this will sense. And this electronic part will convert this pH value into a numeric value. Okay. So the chemical involved, okay, what is that? pH means percentage of hydrogen. How much is involved? That is converted to electrical signal. Okay. Physical transform. You see, I don't know how many of you have seen this. Can anyone tell what is this sensor? It is somewhat bulky. All the other sensors are very simple. This is a bulky sensor. See, if I press it, some electrical pulse will go. So this is called a load cell. Okay. So load cell, this is used in all weighing machine. Okay, starting from your grocery, vegetable shop, all your weighing machine will have only this sensor. So this is connected to another circuit. Okay. Actually, this is the sensor which will produce electrical signal. This is being processed, magnified, and it is given to one display where you can see what's happening. So this can sense up to 10 kg. Okay, it can bear 10 kg of weight. Okay, this is a load cell. Similarly, electrochemical transform. Combination of, you can mix two electrical chemicals or two electro, like thermocouple. Okay, so you are dipping the two electrodes in some copper and non-copper material in different fluid, from which we are generating the electrical pulses. And third type of biological transformation is biochemical transformation, physical transformation, and applying your diagnosing, okay, by inserting some sensor, what happens to the particular organ, okay. You are going to see whether the organ responds, like the stethoscope, okay. You keep the stethoscope and hear whether your heart is beating at regular intervals, at correct rate. Okay, so based on the effect of the test organism, we are trying to confirm or diagnose the performance of any organ. This is applicable for all living beings. And what type of stimulus we can use? So we have acoustic, biological, like that I have listed out. Under acoustic, these are the parameters being measured. So there's no limitation. I have listed only few. As sensor technologies keep on growing, as our keynote speaker pointed out, we are moving towards nano sensor, MEMS sensor. We are implanting. Okay. Nowadays, all the watches are becoming smart watches. I have a very old digital watch. But these are replaced by smartwatches. So where I can check how many steps I walk, what is my heartbeat. So more sophistication, comfort has come. So lot of parameters are measured. So like acoustic, biological, chemical, electrical, magnetic, optical, mechanical, radiation, and doubt. So let me show another video. How sensors are used. From my side, audio is coming.
Sir, really nice video clipping, sir.
Okay. Audio okay?
No, sir. No audio, sir.
But actually, audio is there. I don't know. Any setting is missing. So, related to this sensor, only I connected two videos. These are available in the YouTube channel under this engineering, interesting engineering. Lot of videos are there, very useful. What's happening in the industry, what's happening across the world in different universities. This will be useful for the teachers to have some collaboration with the such universities or to emulate such sensors in our country. So, like the Made in India concept. Okay. So, you see, as per the video, what is conveyed is at one stage we are not going to read any book, like we are not going to memorize the presentation I'm giving. Just the sensors will collect the information and pass it to your memory. So wherever you go, you'll be looking like half a robot. Okay, so you'll be half a human, half a machine. So memorizing is not at all a problem. That's what that video is about. Learning is going to be wide soon. Okay, because of implantation of so many sensors, so your glass will read everything and it will take everything to the memory. Okay, you need not read everything line by line. Very quickly you can do it with the help of all these sensors. So coming to the next part of the sensor. Normally, if you are going to define about the sensor, some specifications need to be mentioned for an application. Okay. For example, I'm going to use one sensor like the thermal sensor or humidity sensor. How are you going to use, what should be its value at all? Some parameters should be defined. So they are listed out here. So regarding sensitivity of a sensor, the specification should be stability. Whether the value coming out of the sensor will be stable throughout the usage or only for short term it will be working. After a month, it won't show the correct reading. It may show variable value, whether it is stable or unstable. And how accurate it is. Okay, I am measuring the temperature of my body with this thermistor. I'm purchasing a low-cost thermometer. The value will not be accurate. If you spend much good quality thermometer you have, it will show the accurate value. If the sensor, the thermistor quality is very poor, and accuracy will go down. And the speed of response, how fast the stimulus is sensed and converted to electrical signal is an important thing. Okay, for a critical cases, not only in medical field, healthcare, even in industry, suppose one boiler or some plant, atomic power plant, has some problem, or you take a rocket launching. The last minute, some bug has been detected by a sensor. ISRO is stopping the launching. They are postponing to the next day. This is because of the quicker response from the sensor. So some bug has been sensed. There is some snag, a scientific snag has been identified. Because of that, the launching is postponed. Suppose the sensor is very slow, after the countdown is over, once it is launched, after that, if the sensor is responding, there's no meaning. It will lead to battle and a loss of money, a loss of so many things. What to say? The government is investing millions of rupees for developing one satellite. All the efforts taken by thousands of scientists in ISRO, DRDO, everything is lost within a fraction of time. If it is sent in advance quickly, then we can stop the launching, we can restore it, then we can launch it at a later date. And the overload characteristics. So every sensor has got some limitation, okay, some range. It should not be overloaded so that if it is overloaded, it cannot sense it. It has got its own range. If you give some input beyond that, it cannot sense. Similarly, hysteresis, operating life, car size, weight, all these things should be specified if you are going to use a sensor. If you are going to purchase a sensor, all these things should be considered. After that, only you have to use it in your application. Similarly, regarding the stimulus range, how much is the resolution? What is the selectivity? Under what environmental condition it will work? What is the linearity? What is the dead band? We are going to see one after another. Okay. So these are the parameters to be considered while selecting one sensor for an application. Blindly, you should not take one sensor. Suppose I am saying this is a thermistor, you can use it everywhere. Even I have faced a problem. Actually, I purchased one digital, it is called a digital multimeter, sorry, thermal meter, thermometer, but it's not used for human purpose. It is meant for sensing the AC. Okay. A similar sensor is used inside the AC. So, if the sensor is not responding, I am setting the room temperature, the AC temperature to 25. But if it is not sensing it properly, it is setting to 26. Then instead of cool atmosphere, the air will be very hot. Okay, so that's why not only for sensor, any material you are going to use in any design, the specifications need to be considered very carefully. So what are the characteristics of the sensor to be monitored carefully? The input and output. What type of input you are going to sense? Whether it is temperature, pressure, or light, or anything else. Similarly, what will be the output? What's the expected output? Whether you require the output of the sensor is only in frequency, or it is in current, or whether it is in voltage, or it is in phase, or in power. Okay, or like vibration, like this piezoelectric. So there are some variations. Output can sometimes be displacement, like thermometer, piezoelectric sensor, and all. That's why you told at the beginning, some sensors combine both transducing property, like sensing as well as actuation. So piezoelectric crystal is the best example for it. It will sense as well as actuate. Okay. So if you use it as a sensor, if you apply vibration, it will generate electrical signal. Or if you apply electrical signal, it will produce vibration. So some sensors behave in both ways. It has both the properties, like the sensing and the activation property. So in order to study the characteristics, the transfer function is one of the parameter to be considered. There is a relation between the input and the output. Whether the performance is linear or non-linear, they can be expressed. The other name for transfer function may be like input-output characteristic function, transfer characteristic function, or response. So the response may be either linear or non-linear, maybe single value or multi-value. Okay, multi-value means what? Single stimulus, multi-value is coming means it is not same. Okay, the response is linear or non-linear, whether it is proportionate, how much input I am giving. Proportionately, the output is also varying. These are all indicated by this transfer function. Okay, in most of the cases, this is very difficult to express mathematically. That's why we use graphs. Okay, using graphs, the input output response, the characteristics are used to indicate the transfer function, how the input is transformed to the respective output. So these are often defined from the calibration data. We'll see at the end what is calibration, what's the need for it. And other data we are extracting from transfer functions are saturation, sensitivity, hysteresis, full scale, dead band, and all. Okay. One more important parameter is impedance. Okay. Impedance matching. Okay. The, as electrical and electronics teachers, you may know the importance of impedance matching. Suppose I am designing, I have one speaker whose impedance input impedance is 3 ohms or 8 ohms. Okay, the impedance of the speaker is only very, very low. It is only 3 ohms or 8 ohms, 10 ohms or 11 ohms. It is not in kilohertz. So this will be as sensitive, very, even if a small signal is coming, it will vibrate. Okay, the speaker will vibrate. So the impedance matching is very important. One important theorem you have to remember here. That's called the maximum power transfer theorem. Okay, maximum power transfer theorem. If the load impedance and the impedance of the circuit are same, then only maximum power will be delivered to the load. Suppose I am connecting one power amplifier to the speaker. So I am connecting one microphone, then power amplifier, then speaker. The microphone impedance would be high so that noise will not come. Okay, input impedance will be high, whereas output impedance will be very, very low. So I am designing one power amplifier whose output impedance is some 100 ohms or 1000 ohms, which is connected to a speaker. Speaker will expect the same impedance of 3 ohms or 8 ohms or 11 ohms. They are not matching, the maximum power will not be delivered. Whatever you are talking will not reach the speaker. Okay, so that's where this impedance and the impedance matching is very much important. Okay, so the output impedance is relevant for sensors, because a sensor is connected to a circuit, its impedance and the circuit impedance should be matching. Then only whatever signal variation, minute signal variations are coming, that they will be properly reflected in the conversion. Otherwise, if impedance matching is not there, then if maximum deviation is there, then only the conversion will be happening, that will be sensed by the circuit. So then your sensor amplifier is a wrong amplifier. Okay, similarly, actuators. For actuator, the input impedance is relevant, input impedance of the load. Okay, so one of the examples of actuator is this. Can you identify the sensor, this actuator? So I am applying some electrical signal here. Then this will make a contact or break a contact. Okay, this is a relay. Okay, this is another sensor where I am giving electrical signal. This is a water pump for a project, so purpose we are using it, small water pump. So this motor inside will suck the water and pump outside. Okay, only if you apply the voltage. Okay, so this is what mentioned here, the impedance matching. And another parameter is range and span. Range is nothing but what's the lowest value of the input and the highest value of the input. Like the temperature varies from my thermometer can sense only from 20 to 80. Above 80 cannot sense, then I cannot use. That is overload. Or I am using temperature, I am putting in ice. This cannot sense because minimum value is 20 degree. Okay, I want a 0 degree for ice. Or hot water, 100 degree. I cannot use. So the range is important for a sensor. And span is the arithmetic difference between highest and the lowest value of the sensors. Lowest value of the stimulus. And the span is always called IFS, input to full scale. Output full scale is nothing but the difference between the upper and the lower range of the output. Output of the sensor. And dynamic range is the ratio between upper and the lower values, which are expressed as dB. Okay. One example is given like this. The range is minus 30 to 80 degree. The span is the difference. Okay, 80, the maximum 110 degrees. 110 means not maximum. The span, okay, minus 30 to 80. How much temperature it can measure. So that's called IFS. Output full scale is the average or the output. 2.5 volts is the maximum value. 1.2 is the minimum value. The difference is the output full scale. Dynamic range is the maximum by input expressed in decibel. So 80 by 30. Okay. Another important term, everyone who are teaching instrumentation, control and instrumentation, they'll be concentrating much on accuracy. Okay. As an electronics engineer, we'll directly purchase, looking at the specification and we'll do. At the same time, you have to see the accuracy also. For industry, accuracy, error, precision, all these parameters are very much important. So accuracy is nothing but the maximum difference that will exist between the actual value and the indicated value at the output of the sensor. So it can be expressed either as a percentage of full scale or in absolute terms. Okay, as a percentage, we can express how much accuracy, 100% accuracy or 90% accuracy, or in terms, okay, 99 point, the accuracy is this much value. Okay, this is able to produce output of 1.52, 1.5777, the exact value may be given. Error is nothing but the deviation of the value, stimulus converted value from the ideal value. Okay, for ideal response, it should produce some 3 volts for a given input, but your sensor produces only 2.5 or 2.98, so there's an error of 0.02 volt. So that deviation is called error. Okay. So this error is because of so many sources. Okay, we cannot get the ideal value in reality. The reason is the material we are using. Even you take the resistor, ordinary resistor, we are saying it is 1 kilo ohm resistor. We are giving some tolerance, plus or minus 10%, 5%, okay, 20%. Because of the material we are using, this tolerance varies there. Okay. Then aging, because of aging, the errors keep on increasing. Then operational errors are coming because of the way they are connected, how they are used in the atmosphere, in the situation, in the application. Sometimes calibration may be wrong. Some standard equipment will be there. Using that, we'll be checking what's the error. Okay, calibration is very, very important in the industry for all meters for instrumentation. Okay, the matching or loading errors may come. Matching is impedance. Impedance is not matching, because of that it is showing wrong value. And loading, okay, it's going beyond the actual value, and because of the external condition like noise. So They may be defined as a difference in three different ways we can define errors. Error may be defined as a difference or as a percentage of full scale or in terms of output signal expected. So in three different form, error can be expressed. There are so many errors, like the static error. Static means whatever may be the environment, whether it is hot or cold, the error is fixed. So it is time, whether you are measuring at the morning or after 10 seconds or 20 seconds or after 5 hours. Whenever you measure, same error is coming, then it's called static. It is not time dependent. The errors keep on changing based on the environment and time. Okay, at one time it shows 5 volts. At another time it shows 4.9 volts. At one time 4.8 volts. So it is keep on changing. That is dynamic. Random error, different errors in a parameter or at a different operating times. Another is systemic error. So errors are constant at all times and conditions. It's more or less like static error. Okay. Another characteristic is repeatability, otherwise called reproducibility. The failure of the sensor or the actuator to represent the same value. Okay. That is a stimulus or the input which are going under identical condition may fail. Okay, so they may fail to show the same value. Okay. I am using for a particular environment, particular time, same sensor at one time, it's dynamic. So reproducibility is not happening. This is viewed as an error. This is usually associated with calibration. Okay. So it is given as maximum difference between two readings taken on different times under identical input conditions. So they are given as percentage, already for difference percentage, like that we have different way of showing these characteristics. And sensitivity. So sensitivity is nothing but change in the output for a given change in input. It is usually a unit change in input. It represents the slope of the transfer function. If you draw the characteristics input versus output, the slope is taken as the sensitivity. So we saw what are the parameters to be considered under sensitivity in the So analyzing sensitivity is a difficult task because there may be some noise, and because of too many combined function, sensitivity may be varying. And the transaction steps may be added up. So, sometimes sensor may be classified like direct sensor and indirect sensor. Direct sensor means you are taking the output directly from the sensor. Another thing is after the sensor, so many stages of different sensors may be available from where the electrical signal is generated. So in such case, this sensitivity will be varying. So that's why it is mentioned as it's a difficult task to analyze sensitivity of a sensor. Like this fiber optic sensor. Okay, fiber, if you apply light on the one side, on the other side, you can generate the electrical pulse. But the same sensor, it's affected because of so many errors. Like if you press the fiber, okay, because of the variation in the refractive index, the signal may be wrong, output may be coming. Okay, the phase of the output will come, phase of the output will change. So you'll get a wrong sensor output. So this is happening in optical sensor. This is one example. Similarly, that of sensors are there where different errors are accumulated. This is not because of the stimulus or because of the device. It is facing different transaction shifts. Okay. And non-linearity is another property where this affects the accuracy of the sensor. So it is defined as the maximum deviation from ideal linear transform function. Normally, it is not known. The maximum deviation is very difficult to sense. Then saturation is another characteristics, frequency response. As electronics people, you may be knowing what is frequency response. And the half power point. And response time, already at the beginning I told, what is the response time? How fast the sensor is able to produce the steady output? Okay, the rocket launching. Okay, if the response is very slow, it may lead to a lot of loss. Not only in psychology, in our medical diagnosis, okay, a lot of diseases are infecting human beings. If you are not diagnosed at a proper stage, or the sensors fitted, we have a pacemaker as an alternate to our heart. The pace changer is not responding. If it is not producing proper pulses at regular intervals, then your system will malfunction. Okay. So response time is very, very important, like the sensitivity, accuracy, and all. Almost all the characteristics need to be considered depending upon the product and the application where it is being implemented. Okay. For study purpose, like the student's project, where output is not a big thing, even if it is wrong, which is not going to affect the society, it's not a problem. But if it is going to be a product which is coming in the market, which is used to help a person to diagnose a disease, or for a physician to diagnose a patient's condition, all these characteristics are very, very important. For sensitivity, let me show one more sensor. Can you identify what is this? This is a toy car. Okay, just 100 rupees car. There are no electronics involved. Okay, you see at the top, we have only photovoltaic cell, PV cell. That is, solar cell is present. Only a few gears are connected at the bottom, which are connected to the wheels. Okay, if I focus light, this vehicle will move very fast. So according to the intensity of the light focused on the solar cell, it moves. You see, at present I am sitting in the cabin. The light coming from the tube light is not sufficient. So its sensitivity is very, very less. Whereas if I keep under sunlight, immediately it responds very fastly, this is moving. So this is one example to explain the sensitivity parameter. Okay. So solar cell, I'm having 100 rupees worth small toy to show for study purpose I'm using it. Okay, there are no circuit involved in it, just only one solar cell is there. So fast response time is always desirable. Slow response time tend to average readings, which is not at all preferred. Large mechanical systems will have always slow response time. That's a problem. Because they told this solar cell is connected to a gear, a plastic gear. Mechanical system means they cannot react. They cannot operate in nanosecond or microsecond. It will take some seconds. Whereas the electronics system means very quickly they can react. Similarly, size of the sensor is another matter. So smaller sensor will almost respond very quickly. Bulky sensor will react very slowly. Okay. So depending upon the application where you are using and the type of sensor, size of the sensor, the response time may vary. So finally, this calibration. So calibration in industry is an important parameter for any instrument and sensors. If any ISO people are coming, first question they are asking is whether all the instruments are calibrated or not. For example, you got one multimeter, or you got ammeter, or voltmeter. whether they are calibrated or not. If they are not calibrated, there is a possibility of errors. Lot of errors may come. Okay, so the newly designed ammeter or voltmeter has to be cross-checked with the standard meter. Okay, that is calibrated. You have to compare the value of your meter and the physical, the standard meter. It is called the experimental determination of the transfer function. They are needed when a device must be operated at tolerances below those specified by the manufacturer. Okay, so this can be done by establishing the transfer function. Normally, we'll have some NABL certified industries. Okay, National Accreditation Board of Laboratories, they will have the standard meters. So you have to compare its reading and your meter reading. Based on that, how much error is coming in your multimeter or ammeter. Similarly, how much error is produced by your sensor. So if more error is there, then that has to be replaced. Okay. So calibration is an operational requirement, especially in mechanical production industries, where this thermocouples, pressure, force, displacement, these are very much used as the stimulus. So calibration data, the table will be given by the manufacturer. They will be included with the design document. Errors coming because of the calibration should be evaluated and specified. How much error this will come, this will produce, that should be known. So accordingly, we can identify. Suppose I got the thermometer, the error rate is plus or minus 5 degrees. Okay. Then it is a big error. It is plus or minus 0.02 degrees. So okay, accuracy is more. Error is less. Okay. So the meters, everything should be calibrated, then only the electrical signal can be taken as the original output of the sensor. Okay, sensor is producing some output, your electrical circuit is showing some other value, so there is no relation. Then this will be a useless way of measurement or implementation of the sensor. And there is how much incremental value, that's called a resolution. For A to D converter, DC converter, you might have used this word. Same thing is applicable for sensor also. For how much minimum variation? Okay, even if there is minor pressure variation, the output should respond. Like the load cell, where I have shown, only if I give a lot more pressure, then only it will produce signal, then resolution will be very, very less. Even if I press with the lower pressure, it should produce some change. Minimum increment should be there. So the magnitude of the input change which results in the smallest discernible output. So that is available. That is also another parameter to be considered. So in addition to that, reliability, dead band. Dead band is nothing but the lack of response or insensitivity of a device over a specific range. As I told, this overload. Okay. So it is designed for a particular range, but the stimulus is applied some value which is beyond the specified band, the span. Then it is insensitive, it cannot respond. Okay, so such inputs should not be used. For example, the ammeter I am having, it is able to measure only 1 kilo ohm, but I am connecting one resistor with the 10 kilo ohm. It won't respond. It will show the needle will go away in the analog meter. And the multimeter, if you connect 1 kilo ohm and setting the value to ohm, it will show infinite. Only one it will show. Okay. So that is called a dead band. Another parameter is called excitation. The electrical supply required for operation sensor, it should specify the range of voltage under which electrical which the device should operate. So that's also important, because you see I have this pump, this is operating at 5 volts. Some range it may operate from 5 volts to 8 volts. Instead of that, if I give 3 volts, it won't work. If I give 10 volts, it will will be damaged, it will be condemned. So that that is very important. Similarly, a relay. If I want to operate the relay, I require 12 volts. Then only it will turn on. If I give 6 volts or 8 volts, it won't work. If I give more than that, it will be damaged. Okay. So that's called excitation. Excitation is the power supply required for operation of the sensor. So these sensors you would have seen. You see this range sensor. These are the sensors normally in academic side students will be using for projects. Okay, you see this is one LED, high voltage LED. This is gas sensor, this ultrasonic sensor, you see ultrasonic IR sensor. I got almost all the sensors with me. Okay, heartbeat sensor. I'll come to the, before seeing the application, I'll come to the limitation. Okay. So limitation of the sensor is, low cost devices are not as accurate as the devices used in industries. Okay, I got tens of sensors. I won't say these are accurate because these are low cost. Okay, this is one gas sensor, this is ultrasonic sensor. In the industry, if I use the same sensor, it may give wrong value. Okay, there will be some offset. It is not calibrated, it is not linear. Okay, so this is not accurate. This is the problem with the sensor. So, in sensor itself, we have commercial sensors, military grade sensors in industry. Okay. Where more accuracy is required, the design itself is different, the material used for sensor is different. Okay, so they will provide accurate value. Okay, so these are the sensors what we are using for study purpose, for project purpose. They are low cost, so accuracy will be very less, and the data we are receiving is not authentic. Okay, and it is difficult to get authenticated data, but we can use some software application to make it more sensitive. So using your program, you know, using your Arduino or Raspberry or MATLAB or LabVIEW software, we can LabVIEW will have some accurate sensors. National sensors or National Instruments is coming with the high quality sensors which are industry standard. Okay. So coming to the last part of this presentation is application. Okay, so application, I cannot restrict, we cannot say sensors are restricted to only this domain. In the first slide itself, it is given us, it is omnipresent. Everywhere it is used, from living beings, non-living beings, everywhere it is used. They are used for comfort, security, safety, automation, like this. The pictures I have shown, these are given by Tata Motors. So in automation, in recent cars, if you take any car, if you have minimum 50 to 100 ECUs, electronic control units, they have a lot of sensors, starting from the key. We have a remote keyless entry, so you need not carry the key always, just to keep it in your pocket, just to go nearby, the car will be automatically turned on. Okay, similarly, we have sensors fitted in every part, like the airflow, throttle, position sensor, auto lock, anti lock braking system. This is very important. Almost many cars are displaying this feature in. On the back side, it has got ABS. ABS means anti-lock braking system. So if you put the brake, all the four wheels will be applied a brake. So it is anti-skidding feature. Okay, during the rain or you are driving a car in a hilly region, so your car should be very safe. And if you apply a brake, all the four wheels should be synchronized. So that is possible only with the puff ABS. So ABS depends on sensors only. Okay. Similarly, thermocouple, we have a lot of thermocouples, labs used. The real application in the industry are in plastic injection molding machinery, food processing, engine and turbine, and exhaust gas, semiconductor processing. So wherever you want to measure the temperature, okay, this thermocouple plays a major role. Similarly, thermistor. I showed one type of thermistor. This is another thermistor used in industries. Similarly, this gas sensor. Okay. Similar gas sensor is not constant. For every gas, separate sensor is available. Like for process control, separate gas sensor is available. For environment monitoring, boiler, fire detection, alcohol, break by police officers during night time, during policing. They use some alcohol, whether the driver's driver has consumed alcohol or not, to test it, they have the sensor. Okay. Detection of harmful gases, home safety. So this is used for home safety. Grading of agro products like the coffee, spices, mango, like that, wherever to check the quality. Based on the gas, these gas sensors are very much used. So coming to the last part, you see the current trends. Everyone is talking about IoT, IoE, Internet of Things and the Internet of Everything. Sensor plays a role. If there are no sensor, we cannot use anything. So we have wearable sensors, portable sensors, implant sensors, which are coming as nano, in nano form, MEMS form, in cars. We have connected vehicles. One car can communicate with another vehicle. Suppose an accident has occurred 1 kilometer ahead, the car will communicate to your vehicle. It has faced the accident, so go to alternate. So we have autonomous vehicles. These autonomous vehicles are possible only with the help of the sensors. So without drivers, a driver need not have a driving skill. They can travel in a vehicle. All the vehicles can be interconnected. So that's a trend very soon it will be coming. Google has already tested in US. And in agriculture, it is very much required. At homes, industry 4.0, 5.0, machine to machine communication. Everywhere, sensor is playing the major role. So finally, to conclude, sensors rule the world. There are no sensor, there are no life. Okay, from our body, if one of my sensory organ is not working, I face the problem. So we have a very complex sensory network. Okay, if there is a problem in my body, in any one sensor, the normal lifestyle is totally affected. Okay. In living beings. Similarly, wherever in the machine, okay, you take your own computer, your mobile phone, your cell phone is not working. Sorry, cell is working, camera is not working. Urgently, you want to take a copy, okay, copy of some picture. Your camera is not working. Camera is working, but it is not stored. Memory is full. Or this accelerometer is not working. Gyroscope is not working. Your security, thumb sensor is not working. Security is lost. Safety, somebody will have stolen your, somebody may steal your phone. So everywhere sensor is there. So without sensor, no life. That has, we have come to such a situation. Okay. Because corona, every day we are using a lot of sensors. Now Omicron, again, similar sensors, medical sensors. Okay, to go to office, go to home, lot of sensors fitted, cameras, your television, your microwave oven, your refrigerator. Okay, everything is fitted with sensors. Okay, so sensor plays a major role. I think this introduction is sufficient. This let me conclude.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Any feedback? Any questions?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now question answer session. Any questions from the participants?
So this is a basic topic. Whatever I have covered is very basic.
Yes,
most of the teachers might have known this.
These components.
So these teachers should use all this. These are very cheap. Okay. IoT is not a tough area. Anyone can work. Even civil engineers, civil students, even art students, having science knowledge is required.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. I would like to express my gratitude to our expert resource person, Dr. P.K. Jawahar, sir, professor, for delivering the introduction of the sensors to the participants of the AICTE Teaching and Learning Atal Academy sponsored 1 week online faculty development program on sensors technology. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
12:30. Participants, next session at 12:30, it will start. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Saleli?
Sir, yes, sir. We can leave, sir.